Indoor, Professor Jean Morse, as really the pushers, the leaders in driving this. And we think it has taken seed. I expect us to see good results coming forward from that. Already it's bearing fruit in terms of grant funding and participation. We're also working to promote stronger alignment of our research to the private sector and the public health sector. So this week, I'm happy to say, as we speak, our principal will be signing off on a grant funding coming out of USAID for $45 million Jamaican dollars to set up a HIV private sector coordinating unit that the faculty will be leading on. Thanks to the work of Dr. Jeffrey Barrow, who is here. Jeff, raise your wave. People know who you are. And Professor Michael Boyne, Department of Medicine, leading on this initiative. That's the kind of work that we also want our research to be taking on. We want to make an impact. We want to address current problems. We want to be socially accountable as a faculty and as a research entity. So in 2019, as we look at health improvement, we're not only concerned with the social determinants of health and the macro determinants, the big issues, that's important. But I want to congratulate the research organizing team, Dr. Walters, for your vision in taking on some of the micro determinants of health. So in this conference, we're going to be looking at genomics. We're going to be looking at where there's the whole issue of genetics and its application to public health and medicine play a role. And I think that's an exciting adventure. I'm delighted to have, I think, the best man for the job, for this particular job, this task. Best in a number of ways. Professor Franklin Prendergast, number of reasons. One, you're one of us. We've met and we've been chatting about his passion and his interests. He's really, this is a homecoming for us, sir. Graduated in 1968, and I won't steal the thunder of Prof. Reed, who will introduce you, but a distinguished alumnus of the Faculty of Medical Sciences, and who you will hear later on as he brings this Ken Standard distinguished lecture. A lot of his research, a lot of his wisdom that he's going to bring for us this morning. So colleagues, friends, visitors, our special guests, our students who are visiting, I want to really welcome you to this special event this morning. This is the big opening of our research conference, or 2 days of conference, 3 days. We have this celebration each year where we really do it in the honor and memory of Sir Kenneth Standard. You are, by the way, in the Sir Ken Standard lecture theater. You're getting the lecture in Sir Ken Standard lecture theater itself. And I welcome you all, and we look forward to a very pleasant and exciting morning. Thank you. So I have the pleasure of continuing to lead you through the program this morning. And the next speaker is one who is an absolutely brilliant researcher, has made his name in the environmental field, the field of environmental science, and you know across the board has made an impact in that area. And he's genetically connected to Mona campus. And so please join me in welcoming our distinguished principal, Professor Dale Weber.
Thank you very much, Dean. In fact, you're beginning to sound like some of my friends, you know. So there's this running joke that I'm monocentric. But I will accept it, and it then gives me utmost commitment to do everything I can for everything that belongs to Mona. Dr. Tomlin Paul, Dean of the Faculty of Medical Sciences, Professor Franklin Prendergast, guest lecturer and the Director Emeritus of the Mayo Comprehensive Cancer Center. The family of Professor Sir Kenneth Standard. Mr. Dunstan Brand, I know he's supposed to be here. I haven't seen him coming, but it's important that he gets here because we want to talk a little more about the partnerships. Professor Marvin Reed, Deputy Dean, who is spreading his wings and his resources, and we'll take advantage of everything. Marvin doesn't know that we will take everything and leave him nothing, but still thank him. Dr. Christine Walters, Chair of the Organizing Committee for the Faculty of Medical Sciences Annual Research Conference, and Dr. Romaine Edwards, Chair of the Opening Ceremony. our partners from the SUNY UWI group, with whom we will continue to expand and explore. Conference presenters, and I flipped through the list and I realized there's so many names here of persons who, some of them I went to school with, some of them I've never heard before, and I'd like to hear them speak so that they can attack with their presentations. Faculty members, members of the administrative and support staff, students, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to you all. It is my privilege and pleasure to welcome you to the University of the West Indies Mona Campus and the Faculty of Medical Sciences 28th Annual Research Conference and Workshop Series. I'd like to welcome especially members of Sir Kenneth Standard's family, because it was his vision that started a lot of where we are now. There's a special place in our hearts for Sir Ken, and his work exemplified the brand of scholarship and practice that took academic back to the community and made such a difference in so many lives. So thank you very much for continuing to share him and his memory with us. Joining us to deliver this morning's lecture is Professor Franklin Prendergast, a distinguished lecturer himself in the area of molecular pharmacology, experimental therapeutics, and is considered to be an authority in individualized medicine. But I learned a lot more from him this morning that I'm sure he will share as we talk. We had a little discussion, the dean himself and I, this morning. I'm certain that his presentation will raise some eyebrows, as it did mine this morning. His presentation will set the stage for much of what will go on throughout today and the next 3 days. And as an alumnus, I know that he will always come home. So for you, this is not a welcome, this is a welcome home. But with that discussion this morning and where I know his mindset is, there's a wealth of experience and information that we should tap into. There are opportunities that we should open, and he has kindly consented to become our next ambassador to help us open some of those doors so that we can take advantage of the opportunities that are there. We're happy to welcome the permanent secretary as he walks through the door. Good timing, Dunstan. We're happy when our colleagues have exquisite timing and they join us, because the partnership between the government and the university is a very close one. Not just because we take their money, not because we work with them on their goals, but because we have the same ideas as to where we want to take the university and what we do. So we could always do research. We could study why is the grass green, but how is that of national and regional importance? We want to get the questions asked by the governments so that we can answer their questions. We should be the research engine, the research arm that public and private sector seek to answer the questions that are out there. We pride ourselves in doing so, and it's a part of our academic industry partnership on which we can grow. The Faculty of Medical Sciences, actually, through this annual research conference, epitomizes what we want to do in terms of getting better health to our people. I'd like to commend the organizing committee for designing such a program. In fact, I realized you started early this morning. I thought this was the opening, but it's actually underway already, and we're just catching up. Genomics has advanced the ability of the medical field to treat and prevent illnesses in a more personalized way. Just reading what I've read and listening to Frank this morning, we need to make ourselves ready to use it in the best way possible. It is not a cure for everything, and we may yet get ourselves into circumstances that we now need to extract later on. So we must be careful as we advance. Global research around this area is important, and the Caribbean is a wonderful playground for this to happen. By linking with all our campuses, the University of the West Indies, through its 17 contributing countries, has the opportunity to make an impact in a region where most universities, colleges, and research entities can only impact a single population. We have the opportunity, and we should take advantage of this. As we play our role in developing the competencies that guide us in our health professionals, we must equip ourselves to keep abreast of that which is happening. Not necessarily to go and be able to take it on, because you know my budget is about this big. But if we can find the right partners, right, Dunstan, we can make things happen. This Medical Sciences 28th Annual Research Conference is such an opportunity, because while you are here, you will hear things that some of you have heard before, or like me, you'll hear things you've never heard before. But it should inspire as to what you can do and what you could do with others. It should instill a desire to go and succeed. It should create mentorship opportunities so that the society can benefit from the research that is happening. It also opens the door for multidisciplinary research, which is something the University of the West Indies realizes must be our way forward. We've gotten the Times Higher Education ranking to where we are now, 53% based on research. Not just research, but the citations and who's reading our work and who does it make any difference to. If we're going to maintain that and grow even further, it is the Faculty of Medical Sciences which needs to lead. I'll let you in on a secret. You know that in my previous life, I was Pro Vice Chancellor for Graduate Studies and Research, which meant I read through the data and I went checking. The Faculty of Medical Sciences, this campus, is responsible for 59% of the publications that make a difference in the ranking indices. There's some places you publish and nobody wants to know, you know. But there are other places that you publish and it's very important. You are responsible for a lot of us getting here. To whom much is given? And although we didn't give you any money to do the research, we've given you the opportunities and the infrastructure, and from them much is expected, which means you have a responsibility to keep the University of the West Indies flying high. Research is important for the UWI because we are a research university. There are some others which are teaching universities. We are a research university. And what's the big difference? In a research university, today's research can end up in tomorrow's lecture. If you are in not a tertiary institution, and there are 62 of them operating in the Caribbean space, 62, so there was a time when the University of West Indies could do anything and get away with it, including nothing. Now, we have to be very careful. And our distinguishing feature is research. If you're in another institution where you need to wait on our colleagues to do the research, publish it, maybe get it in a book, then get it read by somebody else. That's 4 years before it gets into the lecture of another institution that claims to be a medical research or medical teaching entity. You have the beauty of doing the research today and popping it into your lecture tomorrow. You can tell them where to go and read it. You can tell them where to go and find more about it. So you are at the cutting edge of your discipline and you're taking our students to that cutting edge at the same time. But in order for us to be successful, the best way forward is partnerships, because we cannot do it alone. And I'm very glad that Professor Prendergast has decided to share with us his thoughts today. We found a partner. In our partners from SUNY, we found other partners. We will continue to open our doors to find as many partners as possible so that we can learn and we can share what we have learned with them. It's a two-way street which we have to take advantage of, but only through our ability to share, our ability to do our research, and our ability and confidence to stand by what we believe in and what we've found, will we be able to take our rightful place. We're not small and insignificant. We are a large institution. We are a forward-looking institution, and this faculty conference allows us the opportunity to shine. We are still the University of the West Indies, and this is our place to shine, your place to shine. I look forward to the next 3 days. Morning.
Principal, we thank you for your passion and your encouragement and your honesty that you don't really give us much money. but we are grateful. We are grateful, and we certainly we appreciate your being here. I think just your presence and your words speaks to us in terms of the support, the push that you have for this faculty, and that you've taken the time to come with us. So thank you very much, sir. Just a few weeks, well, less than a few weeks ago, I met with a team with the permanent secretary, Mr. Brian Dunstan. And he, Mr. Dunstan Brian, yes. Two first names, like mine. Paul Tomlin, thank you. Kindred spirit. And Mr. Brian made it very clear to me that the Ministry of Health and Wellness is the biggest employer for the faculty. That you actually, of those 1,000 graduates that I spoke about on Saturday, that many of those graduates are getting jobs through the Ministry of Health and Wellness. And so that alone, it's we're partners through, you know, whether we like it or not, we are partners, but we are certainly working to continue to build that partnership and to strengthen our relationship with the Ministry of Health and Wellness. And this morning's presence, Mr. Brand's presence here and his words that he's going to bring to us is a symbol of that strengthening of our relationship with the ministry. Let's welcome Mr. Brand, who will now address us.
So, good morning, everyone. I would like to acknowledge and, to acknowledge the protocols that have already been established, and to say that on behalf of the Ministry of Health and Wellness here in Kingston, Jamaica, I am pleased to be party to this very, 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 very important conference that we will be staging over the next 3 days. As the Dean highlighted, the Ministry of Health and Wellness sees itself as one of your closest partners in the area of development, especially in the area of research development. And we are conscious of the fact that the ministry represents, as the Dean pointed out, the biggest user of the resources that are produced by this faculty, whether it be the doctors, nurses, physiotherapists, you name it, we use it. And therefore, the ministry at all levels, especially in terms of our policy objective, we want to engage more with the university. And my message today is about that conversation, about increased engagement. Now, I do not have to tell this audience about the changing dynamics of health in Jamaica and the looming presence of the issues affecting our population when it comes to non-communicable disease. But I'm not here to tell you a tale of woe today, although there is a tale to tell. However, we want to look to the future. What are we looking for as we try to create a new health service delivery mechanism that reaches the population in its changing dynamics? I will want to talk more about primary health care. Now, I know that primary health care is not a very sexy topic, especially for our clinicians who graduate. We have a very difficult time getting them to in our primary health care facilities, especially in rural communities. But the ministry is moving apace to transform primary health care. And we want to transform primary health care in a way that reaches the population at all levels and in all areas of preventative medicine. I'm coining that word if there is no such word. Preventative medicine. Where we believe that our population requires a greater focus on individual responsibility and empowerment to make appropriate health choices. Primary health care, therefore, becomes the vehicle through which the Ministry of Health will be activating that conversation around the necessity for the population to begin to address the looming challenges of non-communicable diseases. In doing so, we will be taking to cabinet in the next couple of months a new primary healthcare model that sees us taking the existing arrangement and moving the pendulum to a space where primary healthcare becomes more meaningful to the location and the population that is being treated. What do I mean by that? Based on studies that we have done in the ministry, there is a growing trust deficit in primary health care, where patients believe that if you want curative, any sort of curative intervention, your first bet is the hospital. And therefore, our hospitals become extremely overcrowded, overburdened, especially in our A&E departments. How do we change this trust deficit? So we analyzed and we asked the population, what has caused this? The first thing that has come up is the absence of clinicians in the primary healthcare facilities. The absence of clinicians. And therefore, we have to begin to remedy this challenge by changing the construct on which we provide clinical services in our primary healthcare facilities. Part of this problem has to do with our ability to retain clinicians in the facilities. So we spoke to the clinicians, and the first thing that came out was accommodation. Where do I live? And therefore, we have to begin to treat with that challenge by creating greater opportunities for living, for accommodation, for clinicians. The next part of the response from clinicians, I don't know how well health will be able to address it, but we have to contend with it, is facilitation for family, schools, entertainment, access to grocery shopping, simple things that make life more pleasant as you work in very difficult circumstances in deep rural communities. The other aspect of building out our new primary care health model is, what type of services do we want to provide in primary health care? And as we begin again to ask the questions, because we believe in evidence-based research, so it's not just a group of people sitting in the ministry and coming up with ideas, we recognize that we need to engage the population more in terms of how they access services. And what we recognize is that no matter how much we build health centers, or put it another way, there is no way the government can build enough health centers over enough time to deal with all the challenges of access that we have. And therefore, we must, in our new primary care model, look at partnerships with the private sector, with private clinicians in their private offices dealing with public patients. And we are in a very early stage of designing that model of how do we engage our private practitioners in rural communities or even urban communities to begin to deal with the primary healthcare challenges that we have. One of these ideas that, and I'm going to, you can't tell anybody, all right? One of these ideas, I don't know, I only have 5 minutes, but I thought this, I couldn't allow this opportunity to miss me, because I'm going to get a lot of feedback from this conversation. One of these areas is to look at our patients who are with hypertension and diabetes, who are stable, who need to come to the doctor every 6 months, and they need to just have the doctor check them, do some blood tests to see if they are maintaining their health indicators. And then they get another prescription and they go along their way. Those people represent 40% of the people who turn up to the health centers. What if we could enter into a private relationship where those patients go to any private practitioner in Jamaica who are registered and access services, and the government does a PPP, a public-private partnership, to alleviate the stressors that we have in the public health system? What if? Those are the type of innovations that we are looking for as we begin to try to treat with the challenges that we are facing in the public health system. And I want to ask you to join us in that creative thinking, out-of-the-box thinking. That idea might not work. I don't know. But what it shows us is that we are willing, as a government, to create, to be creative. And that is where we believe this partnership with the university, a university that always has been creative, can be very fruitful. I really want to thank you for inviting us to partner with you, Dean, Principal, and I wish you all the best as you go through this conference, and we look forward to creativity as we solve the problems that plague us all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Brand. Certainly, the sentiments are very much appreciated, and I think the creative vision is also quite doable, certainly worth a try. We have Prof. Boyne and our colleagues from SUNY will tell you that one of the projects we've been discussing is in relation to diabetes care and facilitating the tracking and the treatment of diabetics in a more aggressive manner and to improve access. In fact, next month is Diabetes Month, November. This month. Yes, we're in November. Next month is Christmas. And we are, as a faculty, we're going to be mounting an exhibit in the faculty museum on diabetes. And it really would be in memory and in celebration of the work of our Sir Alistair McIntyre, our Vice Chancellor, who served in the 80s, 90s. So that is coming soon. In fact, Sir Alistair did tremendous work in building collaboration with UWE personnel and involved the Diabetes Association of Jamaica in establishing the University Diabetes Outreach Program, UDAP, which is still alive and kicking today. Professor Raghubir Singh, as a pioneer and a guy who's been pushing this, the vision of Sir Alistair. So we will honor Sir Alistair in that respect coming soon. So your words on diabetes as an example, the chronic disease, very relevant, very appropriate. We want to take it on and push through with the strengthening partnership with the ministry. Colleagues, at this point, we are going to I'm going to invite the UWE Chorale to come to the front. They're going to be just spreading some joy with their lovely voices on this occasion to us, just to lighten the occasion before we get into the meat of our celebration this morning. Let's give the UWI Chorale a warm welcome to the front.
End. And did you find your pot of gold? Ever catch a shooting star? Ever felt like you were dreaming? Just to find that you're awake, and the magic that surrounds you can lift you up and guide you on your way. I can see it in the stars across the sky. Dreamt 100,000 dreams before. Now I finally realize. See, I've waited all my life for this moment to arrive. And finally, I believe. I believe in the impossible. If I reach deep within my heart, overcome any obstacles, so let my dreams fall apart. See, I strive to be the very best. Shine my light for all to see. 'Cause everything is possible when you believe. I can see it in the stars across the sky. Dreamt 100,000 dreams before. Now I finally realize. See, I've waited all my life for this moment to arrive. And finally, I believe. I believe. Love keeps lifting me higher. Love keeps lifting me higher. Love keeps lifting me higher. Oh. Love keeps lifting me higher. Love keeps lifting me higher. Love keeps lifting me higher, lifting me higher. Much
members of the UWE Chorale. Sitting there, and I'm thinking there must be a study that shows a correlation between good singing and research output. Principal? In fact, I think there's some anecdotal evidence. The chair of our faculty research conference is a top singer on the university singers, Dr. Christine Walters. Yeah? So there is some anecdotal data already. We just need to do the study. When the University College of the West Indies opened its doors in 1948 with the Faculty of Medicine, the decision had been made that it would accommodate 32 students. And at the last minute, it was agreed that there was space for one more. This is something I see as dean. People always say, "Dean, can you take one more student, one more admission, principal?" At the last minute, it was agreed so. And a young headmaster in Barbados, one Kenneth Standard, received an urgent telegram, to find himself at Mona in very short period. And he would become the 33rd of the famous first 33 students. So Sir Ken Standard was a first in a special way, had all kinds of special things in his life, and I'm really happy to see our younger students here who didn't meet Sir Ken, wasn't fortunate like me to have met this wonderful gentleman, this scholar. He was a leader. He was our first professor of social and preventive medicine and first head of the social and preventive medicine department, which is now known as community health and psychiatry. He was the first to get the degree of Doctor of Medicine by thesis at the University of the West Indies. And he did some work on nutrition at that time. He established the first clinic on the Mona campus, which still stands today and services the citizens of Augustown and Bedward Pasture, that community, Hermitage Augustown, and is still attached to the department and doing very well. And he was quite very much involved with the community health aid program, development of community health aides, nurse practitioners, and so on. He was honored by PAHO, Pan American Health Organization, on its centennial as what they call a public health hero. Wonderful, phenomenal sort of award, public health hero. And he got other awards, which I don't know if he were alive, he would tell us which was more significant, but he also got the Chancellor Hall Award, the Lions Award from Chancellor Hall as a super lion. Huh? You chancellorites. But Sir Ken was a gentleman. I think for those of us who he taught, we remember not only the content of what he taught, but his philosophy and his peaceful approach to life and his words of wisdom. One of the things he taught me was that, and he had a beautiful poem, which I need to keep that close. I don't remember the author of the poem, but the words of it relate to saying the most important thing in life, in his view, was how you pass the baton to the next person as you moved on. So all the work we do and all the stuff that he did for Sir Ken, one of the things he instilled in us was make sure you pass the baton to the next person properly and that, you know, we continue that journey. So today we're very happy to honor the memory of Sir Kenneth Standard in this lecture theater, which we have named after him and through this special lecture. And I want to acknowledge the presence of Sir Kenneth Standard's family. And we just ask Dr. Aileen Standard Golson to stand as we just give her a warm welcome and appreciation. Thank you very much for coming. It's now my pleasure to invite our Deputy Dean for Grad Studies and Research, Professor Marvin Reed, who will introduce our distinguished lecturer this morning. I think Professor Reed also has a special surprise. He's a man of, you know, his surprises and stuff. We always have fun around Prof. Reed. So I think he has a surprise which is not in the program, but once he does that, he will introduce Professor Franklin Pendergrast to us, our distinguished lecturer. Prof. Reed.
Morning, everyone. All right, so could I invite Dr. Gene Williams? Can you join me on the podium, please? Donnett Sim Stewart, are you here? No, in which case, Sharon, can you come for me? Joseph, can you come for me? Professor Plummer, I need you on the stage with me. Come, hurry, we don't have all day. Come, Jean. All right, so you would have heard the dean mention in his opening remarks that Dr. Jean Williams Johnson and her team published a paper a few months ago in the Lancet. Every year we know that the principal and his team honor the best publications and scholars from the faculty, but we thought it was important to highlight at least the achievements of some of our staff members, especially those that were involved in what we call clinical trial studies, which is an area and avenue that we're trying to expand and explore across the faculty. So in my first duty as Deputy Dean, I thought I'll give a little token. Come, Jean. Let's give her a big hand for her pioneering study on the CRASH 3 trial. All right, don't move. I would invite Professor Plummer on behalf of Dr. Leek. Come along. Dr. Leek is traveling, so I'm asking Professor Plummer to accept it on behalf. So the surgical team, they published a paper where they did a clinical trial how to fix my hernia and ensure that I get it fixed pain-free. And because Dr. Sim Stewart is not here, I'll ask Sharon to accept this on her behalf. Sharon was the coordinator on this particular study, where we looked at the use of folic acid as whether or not it was effective in preeclampsia. All right. So all of these publication, all of these clinical trials have the potential of changing clinical practice, and they were all published in high impact journals, and they were all conducted within the last year or so. So give a big round of applause to our scholars. All right, thank you. All right, great. So it's my duty now to do the welcome and the announcement for our guest speaker this morning. Now, for the history buffs, you know that Jamaica was colonized by the British, and therefore a lot of our traditions and things that we do have some British connotations to it. But alas, we exist just a few hundred miles from a big North American neighbor called the US. And therefore, more recently, a lot of our procedures and policies and so on have taken on an American influence. But there's one particular American thing that I really like, and that is how they introduce their president. Do you know how they do that? They simply say, ladies and gentlemen, the president of the United States of America. So following that, I can say, ladies and gentlemen, our honor guest speaker, Professor Prendergast. Would that be good enough? No. I think I'll infuse some of my British tradition in the process. So as you all know, Professor Prendergast is one of us. He's a Jamaican or Jamaican, whichever way you want to put it, who was from the class of 1968. He was so bright that they tried to get rid of him very quickly. And at the end of the process, what they decided to do at the university here is to give him an honorary MBBS. All right? Not many of us can boast about that, but Professor Prendergast can. So he's an honorary graduate from the University of the West Indies. So he then decided to take a journey across the seas to the UK, courtesy of the Rhodes Trust. So he liked to use their money. And as a Rhodes Scholar, he did his bachelor's in physiology. Following that, he then went to the great state of Minnesota. You know the great state, right? From the great country. So at the great state of Minnesota, he spent the majority of his professional life, where he did his PhD in biochemistry. And he established an enviable track record of research and scholarship, spanning biochemistry, physiology, and medicine. His research interests, according to my reading, span the gamut of biochemistry and protein molecules, vaccine development, diagnostic and computational medicine, and more recently, as he got more mature, personalized medicine. His work has been recognized by his peers, and certainly by us here in the Caribbean as well. And so, as a consequence, he received several distinguished awards through his professional career. These include, amongst, the Musgrave Medal for his contribution to science from the Institute of Jamaica, two honorary doctorates, one from Purdue University, and of course, one from the University of the West Indies. He also received awards from his membership in terms of the American Heart Association. And all of these really just reflects the caliber of science and the caliber of his professional career. He currently is the Emeritus Professor for the Mayo Cancer Comprehensive Center. And within that context, he will come this morning and present to us along the theme of genomics and health. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the podium Professor Prendergast.
Best thing to say about that is who dat. Dr. Weber, is he here? Principal and Dean Paul. I'm going to ad lib a lot today, I can warn you. And the reason for that is that I want to dispel some myths, if you wish. And I may have to, I'm itinerant, I gotta walk. So I hope I can walk. This is a real pleasure. I want to thank you for the invitation. Christine worked tirelessly and efficiently getting me up at 6 o'clock in the morning. She is relentless, by the way. You have a leveler? Oh, this will work. Yes. So thank you a lot for this invitation. My degree in medicine was here.
They label me all the time as MD, PhD. I am MBBS, PhD, and it was not honorary. I earned that sucker. And the reason I say I want to ad lib a lot this morning is because I do want to ad lib. The work I'm going to talk about first was oriented towards a project that a couple of colleagues of mine and I had in Saudi Arabia. Believe you me, if you want a definition of weird, it's a Jamaican in Saudi Arabia. And my colleagues were the head of the Kaiser Permanente Medical System, a remarkably smart man who I would like to bring here for his wisdom. His name is David Lawrence, and he's a spectacular human being, a wonderful doctor. He really brought Kaiser from the brink of disaster to what it is today, the most prominent single medical system in the United States, at least in terms of volume. And the last was the head of, he came a little later, was the head of the Oxford Clinic in Louisiana. We were given the task of designing a healthcare system for King Abdullah Financial District. This is a remarkably big project. This was before MBS, Mohammed bin Salman. And the sponsor of this program was Mohammed bin Salman's immediate precursor. You all heard of Mohammed bin Salman because you heard of Khashoggi and the slight accident he had. And this was a gentleman by the name of Prince Turki. He had a wonderful name for a Jamaican. Prince Turki bin Abdullah Aziz Al Saud. Took me a week to learn it. We met in his palace, and he had rugs that would have bought the stadium here in this lecture hall. He was actually a very decent, very nice man. He wanted to modernize the primary care system in Saudi Arabia. Now, what most people don't realize is they really don't know anything about Saudi Arabia. It's a country of 26 million inhabitants, indigenous, 6 million expatriates on top of that who do all the work. And 26 million occupy the rim of the country, because in the middle of the country there is only one thing, sand. And it is fascinating to fly over, for example, from Riyadh to Jeddah, and you're flying over 500 plus miles of sand. And you have to admire the indigenous Saudis for what they've been able to achieve in terms of a country. Because with all that sand, all you can think of is more sand. All their water is by desalination, produced in the rim of the country in either the Red Sea or the Gulf of Arabia. The Iranians want to call it the Gulf of Persia. It's all by desalination. And the population skirts that rim, Daman in the east, for example, Jeddah in the west, and you have cities like Medina and Mecca on the west coast, and then Riyadh is sort of in the central east. Riyadh is a city of over 8 million people. So primary care assumes a certain has a certain problem in Saudi Arabia. How do you measure and how do you communicate information? Because everything is very strongly centralized, or it was. It's now a little different compared to 5 years ago. And the discussion we had is, how do we reach the community? How do we reach the population in terms of their health? And how do we recruit data so that they would have an idea? Now, what has surprised me in the last few days that I didn't know is how robust a legacy can stand at the left. So Ken was one of my teachers. We revered him because he was a delightful human being on top of being a very good social medicine person, community medicine person, population medicine person. At that time when I was in medical school, I didn't fully appreciate the importance and value of community medicine, of population medicine, of public health. And the reason I'm starting with that is as a prelude to the discussion we'll have tomorrow about genomics, etc. That's not today, so if you came, you might go have lunch and early lunch. But the whole issue of genomics and population genomics is a vital function for Jamaica. And how can we make it more efficient? How can we give greater access to this? How can we meet the standards of social accountability? A great phrase I learned from Professor Paul this morning, of social accountability, which this university must meet. It's an imperative for the simple reason we don't have the resources to be wasteful such as they are in the United States in many, many locations. And what I want to introduce to you is a little bit about how you do that, even in an age of sophisticated subjects like personalized medicine. So I'll tell you a little bit more about myself. By the way, that was an ebullient presentation from your head of research. You need somebody like that who is going to galvanize the action that you need. That guy scares me. But I compliment him very seriously. I absolutely compliment him because that is going to drive the collaborations and the partnerships and the relationships that Jamaica has to have to grow its research enterprise. I didn't plan to do research. Most of my life in Jamaica was spent by, was characterized by serendipity. Somebody said you should do something, so I did. In fact, most of my life has been characterized by that. We talk about achievement and attainment. As I was mentioning to Professor Weber, the principal this morning, most of my life has been characterized by attainment rather than achievement. And there's a distinction. Distinction is what I put into it as what, in distinction to what somebody asked of me to do. And most of my life has been spent either by serendipity or being asked to do things, and I simply did them. Now, I ended up doing them assiduously, and in the final analysis, well, so my rank rose. The other thing that caused me to rise, especially within a system like Mayo Clinic, which is where I went for my residency in internal medicine, fully intending to stay in Minnesota. And if you don't understand what that means, come spend a year with me in Minnesota. If you want to realize how sensible or stupid you are, you stay a winter there. And I don't see Rondell, actually, Rondell Graham. He's coming. He'll be here presently. Rondell is another graduate of the University of the West Indies. He was the star in the Department of Pathology when he was a resident, and now he's in the star of the department as a staff person. You don't worry about him. His head won't grow big because he is a true scholar. He is a wonderful graduate. We have now six other young Jamaicans from the University of West Indies at Mayo. I was the first, just by accident. I told people, you can't miss me. You want to find me at Mayo? Get a tall stool. Look out over the crowd of physicians. Find the moving shadow, right? Moving contrast, I call it, and that's me. Because that was me. I was the sole one there. Never faced any racism, but I can tell you all about that subsequently. But most of my career there was characterized by somebody telling me to do something, which I did, as I said. I went to get my PhD in biochemistry. And the reason I went to get my PhD in biochemistry, despite having a degree in physiology, was I realized physiologists don't know any biochemistry. And I realized that medicine is not sufficiently capable as a faculty, as a discipline, to teach people the details of the science that you needed to do a lot of modern research. But over that period of time, too, I also learned that research is not an individual effort nearly so much as it is a collective effort. It's a matter, like the team you just saw with the papers from Lancet, those are team efforts. And these are sort of sound like shibboleths, like platitudes coming from faculty or trying to encourage you to do something as a team. It isn't, it's real. And much of my responsibilities, I was director for research there, I was director of the Cancer Center, I was director of the Center for Personalized Medicine, Center for Individualized Medicine. My responsibility was to do something that I see spontaneously being done here, the formation of teams. It was not a platitude, it was real. These were big programs that we built. I was Mr. Rescue, Mr. Fix-It for the Cancer Center, because I wasn't trained in oncology, I was trained in internal medicine.
But the biggest blessing for me as head of the cancer center is I was not an oncologist. I didn't have stereotyped responses. I didn't have stereotyped ideas about how patients should be treated, how they should be managed. I could infuse in oncology the curiosity of the internist. I could change paradigms. I could change treatments. And we grew from an organization that had about $25 million per year in funding from the NCI to an organization that had $152 million per year in funding. We went into rank from 53rd to 3rd, where we still occupy behind Sloan Kettering and MD Anderson. We grew, and it wasn't because of my brilliance. It was simply because I managed to engender and inculcate in the faculty their ability to succeed. That they had the wherewithal, they had the ken. They only needed the effort and the unambiguous support in an institution which gave nobody authority, but which I demanded when I was asked to do the cancer center work, because I said, I don't do it, you in deep tapioca, so choose. Now, you don't say that at Mayo Clinic, they just kick you out. But this time they were desperate, and we succeeded. What I want to inculcate in you all is, Mayo Clinic has the most vaunted reputation in medicine, and it deserves that reputation. It is highly efficient, it is highly effective, but the individual physician is not any better in most cases than any of you in this room. And I can say that because I have proven it, and Rondell has proven it, and Steve Robinson has proven it. The ability is there, it's not the ability. It's the will, it's the drive, it's the ebullience that makes the success. And so for me, for this conference, for example, with respect to research, and I'll get to some issues related to that shortly, my message to you is, if you want it, go get it. You have to perform, and you have to perform well. You don't get into these great institutions. The skin color, by the way, I use a term which Dr. Weber likes, is a pigmentary passport. It opens doors. And make no mistake, I am fully aware that doors that were opened for me in part came from that reality. And there is a sort of perverse incentive on the part of institutions, you know. It's wonderful to be told, look, this is our director for research. He's university. He never says University of West Indies graduate, which ticks me off. It says he was a Rhodes Scholar. He graduated first in his class. He's come to Mayo. He's had a wonderful academic career at University of Minnesota, et cetera, et cetera. As though me as myself is irrelevant. And that is wonderful because it's a nice reflection on the institution. Now, come now, what do you really want to talk about? Is this guy is enthusiastic, he does well, he does his medicine, he treats his patients well, he has wonderful credentials because he's earned them. I have a thing called the law of minimal expectations that is often applied to people of color, where the minute you do something above the low expectations, suddenly you're a genius. It is easily the most insulting thing you can have happen to you. That's the point. So those are my general sort of shibboleths. But I want to turn now to the presentation, because I'm not going to even deal a lot with the presentation. Tomorrow I'm going to talk about genomics. And I'm learning a lot of what is being done here, which is already a wonderful prelude to that world. It's a world which I was inducted into at Mayo, because I was given the responsibility to build the program in genomics beginning about 2009. Now, Mayo has the resources to do this right, because one of the big things is building the infrastructure for this. The second is the knowledge you will acquire because you will acquire it, but building the infrastructure for it. We spent an awful lot of money to do that, and I do not want to encourage the university to spend that amount of money to build a big genomics enterprise. Do it by collaboration. And you already have the collaboration with SUNY. That's what I heard about this morning. as one example, build others, use their capital structure to support what you want to do by having good projects that they are going to want to engage in. And by virtue of the fact that they have the authority to approach institutions like National Institutes of Health for funding, and there is a great deal of curiosity about ethnic issues with genomics. There is also a lot of misconception, and I'll talk to you tomorrow. So tomorrow, by the way, I'm going to tell you, don't do things more than I'm going to tell you, do them. Because as I said, you use that collaboration, and we have somebody here who set up genomics labs here. You can learn a lot from each other and build collaborations and partnerships, etc. Use their capital, you use your mind. And make sure you get the return for the use of your mind, because there's a lot of potential exploitation, all right? So I want to run through just some ideas about primary care, because the data, what you need are data. And then you need the mathematicians and the statisticians, and build a program in bioinformatics, slowly, but build a program in bioinformatics so you can interpret the data. That is the greatest deficiency. So currently I serve on 5 boards of 5 startup companies, all of which deal with computational genomics. And I see the nonsense they're producing. I will divest myself of a few of them because it ain't worth it. I see what the nonsense they're producing, and I see incredible amounts of hype of what we can do. For example, you do your genomic medicine for cancer, and you suddenly come up with novel treatments. That works in a few cases, but in the majority of cases it doesn't work, because they don't have the appropriate algorithms to interpret the data the way you need to have those algorithms in order to come up with new treatments, which after all is the objective. So I see some good nodding heads here, because it is important not to spend money uselessly. What I see here that we need is infrastructure, so that, for example, you can have modern treatments. If you don't mind a quick anecdote, I was with Dr. Lowe, hematologist at the university here, with a patient the other day, and we were talking about multiple myeloma. And it's one of the questions is, should that individual come to Mayo Clinic and get a BMT, bone marrow transplant? Well, a BMT at Mayo Clinic costs $172,000, right? Who can afford that? $18,000 a month. For lenalidomide and the other drugs that are used these days for induction. Who can afford that? The people in the States can't afford them, they're fairly wealthy. We have to find ways of reducing that cost and increasing the effectiveness. But then I spoke with Dr. Dingley, one of my acolytes at Mayo, and he said, Frank, I wouldn't recommend a transplant at all. Why don't you go for CAR T therapy? Has anyone here heard about CAR T? See, but you see, you all should hear about CAR-T. You should understand something, a program we started at Mayo in 1995, which was introduce immunotherapy to the treatment of cancer. And people thought I was mad. The oncologist reviled me and sent me hate mail. Why was I bringing this bogus medicine to the institution? Well, immunotherapy of cancer is now de rigueur. It's the law of the land. Could Jamaica become involved with CAR-T? If you try to buy it, it's $420,000 per patient, per course. That's even less approachable than bone marrow transplant. You hear about stem cell biology. We've started all those programs. We have a very active program in stem cell biology. But the average cost is going to be $200,000 a patient in the US context. Could we do something the same but differently here for less and be just as effective? So the message I want to give you is, you have, this is what you need. You have the human potential. You have the brains. That is what you need to do. In terms of the practical applications to something like primary care, how are you all going to compete in this new world of medicine? Your resources are relatively few. You have to maximize, and I'm sorry, there's Mr. Bryan. One of the things that you are faced with right now is, how do you provide care in a rural setting with a rural community of the type of Jamaica? I would argue it's all going to be due to helped by a digital revolution. Yes. Oh, I will shout at you. What we suggested to the Saudis, they're partially investing in. It is the use of distributed diagnostics at health stations, improvement in your nursing services, so that you have nurse practitioners as opposed to physicians. Send them out into the bush with appropriate telecommunications capabilities. And that's what I want to run through now because I think it is practical for here. You must have somebody who is very familiar with modern technologies and the applications of modern technologies, and then have access to those modern technologies to try them out. For HIV monitoring, for example, there's no need for a person to come into the hospital. There's no need for, they need a nursing station with the appropriate technology, et cetera. So can we run that, those slides? I don't know. Okay, here. So interestingly, that first slide was because these slides were used to introduce a brand new medical school concept, which is a medical school based in a College of Engineering at the University of Illinois, and designed by the College of Engineering, which was implemented last year, and which is a very different curriculum from anything you've seen. The focus is very different. I don't know, have you ever seen this, Michael? Okay. Well, I was intimately involved in that just by being appropriately rude. Next slide. Do you have a pointer? Two books I'd recommend you read if you haven't read them, by Christensen, which is The Innovator's Prescription, and The Creative Destruction of Medicine by Eric Topol. Both of these gentlemen I know. Read them, but they're not Bibles. So don't take everything for gospel. That's the important thing. Build your own model, but predicate in the thoughts and ideas that they have. Next slide. The whole question of individualized medicine has been prostituted, in my view. So I hope some of this gets into the press in the United States. It is not just about genomics. The simple reality is, for example, is science and medicine of human variation and individualized medical need, because every one of us is different, and it's not just because of our genes, as the next slide will show. Next one. So here are features. Genetic variation is one variable, but it is not the sole variable. And what has been ignored by the discussions in the state is the whole question that nature, of course, either in terms of your germline changes or in terms of your somatic cells and those changes, which are more common in most forms of cancer, they give you the potential for genetic variation. And the somatic variations in particular are critically important because they are responsible for the vast majority of cancers, except for pediatric cancers. Now, that does not ignore the reality of tumor suppressor genes and oncogenes. It just says, put the emphasis where it really needs to be. I need to keep my time carefully here. Next slide. Next slide. What is your objective? It is not to create unique therapies for each individual patient. It is to effect more effective what the next one, right? You take syndromes, for example, you dissect them in the context of the last slide, last portion of that slide here, which is schematically represented as a three-dimensional plot where each little circle represents a bin of patients who are sufficiently similar in terms of their biology that they will respond in a common fashion and have common diagnostic features sufficient to identify them as a small group, each of which will represent a unique patient, treatment trajectory. What you want to do is take any new patient that comes along and give me the last of that slide. And they come into a new bin, for example, a brand new patient would come, give me the last, next slide. So fundamentally, you create a new bin. Eventually, if you carried this ad libitum, ad nauseum, you would have individual patients identified with individual therapy. That is impossible.
You don't have enough treatment capabilities to be able to do that. You don't have enough drugs to be able to come to the truly individual level as a rule. It should not be hyped and it should not be exaggerated. And Francis Collins is having a hard time justifying the fact that now in 2020, almost 20, he hasn't realized the dream of personalized medicine. He'll never do it in my lifetime, and probably never, and probably isn't necessary. Next slide. So the critical issue is antibiotics. Oh yes, thank you. The antibiotic paradigm has distorted medicine, in my assessment.
The Mayo's just changed the slide.
Yes, sure.
They're about to fix it.
Yes. Here you are. And the simple reality is that when we talk about disease stratification, we also have to talk about patient stratification. Those are all the features that give you the introduction to personalized medicine, doesn't give you the solution. Again, next slide. Okay. So I'm not going to go through this value chain. I'll do that tomorrow. Next thing. Oh, there we go. The full range of possibilities in medicine covers the entirety of medicine. Keep going. Just keep advancing the slides. Oh, so it's here? Oh, there. Wow. That is, no, you see, I mess it up. I'm technologically incapable. I'll point at you, okay? The point of all of this is this encompasses all of medicine, not just oncology, not just cancer. Cancer was the most unfortunate choice because it's the most complex. Next, just keep advancing through them for me, would you? The point of all of this is the options that this institution has in medicine is to continue to use the paradigm they've always had and to amplify their use of that paradigm with new approaches and new techniques without dramatically changing what they're trying to do. This is now how the Mayo Clinic Cancer Center functions, and it is doing very well. So keep going, just keep going. Don't slow down for me at all. But if you look at this whole paradigm here, and interventions, for example, of disease management, keep going, patient stratification, patient disease profiling, target identification, target validation, pharmacogenomics. Now, let me just stop on pharmacogenomics for a moment because everybody thinks this is the great revolution now in the pharmaceutical industry. So I served on the board of directors at Eli Lilly for 23 years. I'll tell you just one case. It's a case of prasugrel and clopidogrel, both of which require some enzymatic modification in order to be efficacious. Clopidogrel is not metabolized by everyone, especially African Americans. African Americans do not do well with clopidogrel. They do very well with prasugrel. We thought this was going to be the winner to make prasugrel the best drug for platelet adhesion, basically obliteration of that and control of bleeding, control of clotting. It's failed miserably because doctors didn't adopt it. And the community here, do you do tests for prasugrel and clopidogrel? But that genetic test in this community would be invaluable because black people, people with my pigment, do not metabolize. I personally don't metabolize clopidogrel. So it's a useless drug for use in my case. I had a TIA a few weeks ago, and the question was, should I go on clopidogrel, Plavix? And the answer was no, because it wouldn't be any good for me. The point of all of this is, we don't need to try to adopt the mechanism of practice in the United States. We need to create our own. You create the knowledge, you teach the knowledge, you build the appropriate tests, build the genomic enterprise that you need to solve a single problem. The last slide is this. Next. So you see, she's having problems too. Okay. And the last slide is this. You've got to build, in my assessment, a much more robust, responsive
dynamic primary care system that relies on modern digital diagnostic tools to give you the data that you need to advance the whole medical system. And community medicine is going to be the best way that I know of to realize your challenge of social accountability for the medical school. It is also a robust way to get data from which you subsequently can publish papers. The most active field is going to be epidemiology and other features of community medicine, other features of public health. It is also much less expensive than trying to build an impossibly expensive infrastructure that you simply can't afford. So I hope that central message has come through along the way. Now, tomorrow I'm going to speak about the science of genomics. I'm going to speak about the science of hype and the science of effective use of genomics, and that's what I hope. And I'm also going to give three examples that are one originated in Jamaica with a piniwali. Does any of you know what a piniwali is? Basically work that stimulated the imagination of one simple Jamaican, me, that ended up in the final analysis winning a Nobel Prize. And you need to hear of it because it's an example of how a very simple concept, bioluminescence, can yield something of immense value. There are three examples that I'm going to give. And I'm going to leave any of you who come tomorrow with the following question. Why does a red cell die in 120 days? Now you know that, right? This is the average lifespan of a red cell. Why does it happen? I guarantee none of you are answering because you know there's a trick. Why does it die? And what on earth does that have to do with the treatment of malaria? Or potential treatment of sickle cell disease? So that's one question. The second question is, you know all about sickle cell disease. You have one of the best sickle cell research groups here in the world. When Graham Sargent was here and continuing through the successors. Why does a red cell assume a sickle shape? So you're told that HBS polymerizes. What the heck does that mean? I'm not going to tell you because you're going to find out. If you can find it in the literature. I want to tease you with a whole slew of these very simple questions that you presume you know the answer because you know, and I want to make the argument it's less about knowing, and I'm going to see if I can influence Professor Boyne and company to stop teaching so much for people to know and look a little bit more on people to understand. So I will tell you, virtually nobody knows why a sickle cell becomes a sickle cell. We describe it, and we think we know it, whereas we don't also understand. So one of my friends is the world's, I would argue he's the world's expert on sickle cell membrane. I asked him a bunch of these questions. He's investigated them. He's come up with a potential solution which will absolutely surprise and delight you. And it all has to do with that question. Why does a red cell die in 120 days? I posed that question to him 10 years ago. He's answered it reasonably. And it will absolutely surprise you because it also yields a treatment for malaria. That's one we hope to see happen in the next year or two. And so the message I'm giving you is you have all the tools you need to succeed. You have all the tools you need to bring more glory to the university and to yourselves. How do you deploy it? How do we open the gates for you to walk through? But remember, when the gate is open, it needs to stay open. The color of your skin is actually an asset. Use it. But it can't be the thing that sustains people's interest in you. It has to be what you produce and what you achieve. So don't look at me as this wonderful success at Mayo Clinic, because you are going to do exactly the same. I'm going to memorize every face. I'm going to make damn sure that you achieve to the maximum extent of your ability and use your professors, use people like Michael Boyne, you know, like Joe Plummer. They have a lot of experience. They can open doors and walk through it and stay into the next chamber. Don't come out. And don't worry about racism and stuff. This is my last anecdote. When I was a resident at Mayo, as I said, I was the only black person in the place. I mean, even in the whole institution, there were very few. You could find me easily. And I wondered what would happen with the patients. We had a lot of famous patients. I won't name the patient in particular here, but I walked into the room and she said, "Oh my God, you're black." And she was wiggling in the bed. And I looked at her and I stepped back through the door and said, "Oh my God, you're white." She became my very best friend. She was from Mobile, Alabama. She was from Mobile, Alabama. And the last thing, memory I had of her was the fact that she knitted for me every single year an Afghan at Christmas. And she invited me down to her home, and I met her husband, who had been an avowed racist beforehand. And she gave $10 million to Mayo. And her last comment was, "Now, how am I going to tell my husband that I'm in love with a black man?" I've had a wonderful career because of this school, not this immediate faculty. But of all my colleagues here, I'm proud of the university. I'm very proud of what I see emerging. I want to basically compliment Dr. Paul, because I think he has great ideas, and Dr. Weber. They're interested. They're passionate. I will do everything I can for each and every one of you and for the school, because I want to see the school be the shining example for the entire world, and especially for the Caribbean. I will say, Mr. Permanent Secretary, I'm very worried about how the governments of the Caribbean are responding to the university, being very blunt. This is a jewel. I'm very worried about the proliferation I see of universities, because it is not tenable. This is fundamentally not tenable, not if you want to maintain standards. You have to be as good as your mind allows you to be, because the world will not recognize you otherwise, and especially in the age of Mr. Trump, that becomes even more true. You don't want to get me started. And God bless you all. Be good to yourselves first, and trust in what you are and what you can be. Okay? Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much, Prof. I think certainly the words and the content were well received, and I think the philosophy also attached to it, and they really spoken from the heart. No better way to speak to people than from the heart. So we very much thank you, sir. We value the advice, the wisdom, the encouragement that you have brought to us here this morning. And I think very fitting address in the memory of our distinguished professor, Sir Ken, that you've brought to light a lot of what Sir Ken believes in terms of your sharing with us. So let's just give him really a round of applause. I'm going to invite our sub-chair for the opening ceremony, Dr. Romaine Edwards, to make a short presentation to our distinguished lecturer. And you mentioned President Trump. Let's just say this is not quid pro quo.
Professor Pendergast, on behalf of the Faculty of Medical Sciences, we would like to thank you for coming home and intriguing us in genomics. You've asked us some questions that we will make sure that tomorrow we're glued to your presentation, because for those of us who are interested in biochemistry and zoology, we would really love to be able to answer those simple questions. Thank you very much for coming, sir.
Thank you very much.
Now, this you can use the bit to, you know, to basically write.
So as we come to a close, I just would like to myself thank you all for coming, but to give you a better thank you, no better than our singing conference chair, Dr. Christine Walters. So Dr. Walters, please come and bring us the appropriate closure.
Okay, good morning. Not gonna sing. Permanent Secretary, Mr. Dunstan Brown. He is a friend and fellow singer, although I'm not quite sure if he wants everyone to know of his talents. But sorry, Dunstan, the secret is out. Thanks for joining us. And I've learned also, I'm sorry I don't know this as your friend, but happy birthday. Thank you for joining us. Our principal, Professor Dale Weber, our faculty dean, Dr. Tomlin Paul, our newly named and quite effervescent deputy dean for graduate studies and research, Professor Marvin Reed, of course, our distinguished guest speaker, Professor Franklin Prendergast, Dr. Aileen Standard-Golson, who is representing the Prof Standards family, our performers who've left, but we do thank them, and I will convey in person our thanks to the University Chorale for lightening our spirits this morning with I Believe. Our photographer for capturing every moment, our sponsors, our special guests, faculty members, members of staff, students, friends, all. Thank you for your presence this morning. I do borrow from my involvement in theater to say that this conference is a production of key inputs from players, teams behind and on the stage. I'd like to publicly thank, firstly, our dean for chairing this opening ceremony, and especially for planting the seed for this year's theme, Genomics in Health, Medical, Ethical, and Societal Matters. This theme was fine-tuned and developed further through the hard work of our organizing committee and sub-chairs. And I'm not gonna list them all, but certainly our workshop chairperson, Dr. Nadia Bennett, who has, co-chair Dr. Wayne West, who has developed the workshop which will be presented tomorrow. Of course, our administrative support throughout its many cycles, technical support offered by Mr. Damian Brown and the Mona Information Technology Services, that's our MITS team, student volunteers who you'll see floating around, assisting throughout the conference as ushers, timekeepers, and mic runners, and of course our chair of the opening ceremony subcommittee for pulling this portion of the conference together. Importantly, we cannot host a conference of this nature without the input of you. You are faculty, you are our students who've submitted abstracts for reviews and subsequent presentation via, well, orally or by poster. And of course, we thank our faculty members who have reviewed these abstracts. And also those who've agreed to serve as session chairs. So as was said before, we started this morning quite early. We started at 8, well, registration started at 8, and the first session was at 8:30. And so we had four presentations there. And we continue post-launch with two sessions, one for that will highlight the work of basic medical sciences, and another for medicine and surgery. So please do return after lunch. We thank our workshop presenters, some of whom have journeyed here, Prof. Gene Morse and his team from SUNY. We welcome you. And of course, we have our own faculty members who are presenting throughout our workshop tomorrow. And again, we thank you for agreeing to present. Especially want to thank Prof. Plummer, who last year birthed the concept of the Meet the Professors Breakfast Workshop. It continues this year, and primarily the aim is towards encouraging young clinicians to build an academic career. It was a huge success last year, and it was brought back this year. And so we look forward to that. We begin at 7. Registration begins at 7 a.m. tomorrow, bright and early. So all are welcome. So don't be misled by the focus, but all are welcome to listen to our presenters, some of whom have journeyed. That will include Professor Prendergast, Dr. Rondell Graham, and Professor Michelle Reed. We especially, of course, thank Professor Prendergast, who is one of our own, hailing from Linstead St. Catherine. And we thank you for your presentation this morning and look forward to your two talks. So this is a first. Again, another first for you. So Prof. Prendergast is presenting three talks. Usually we have the guest speaker, the distinguished guest speaker, speaking here at the opening and again at the plenary. He will do so again tomorrow, the plenary, but in addition at the breakfast workshop. So thank you again for agreeing to that mammoth task. And just to quickly point out that in a very delightful conversation with Prof. Prendergast some weeks ago, he, well, first of all, told me to call him Franklin, but my parents have taught me better. So I'm sorry, you remain Prof. but he indicated that his needs were simple. He's come to offer much, but he's requiring nothing except for ACCI. So he said, as long as he gets some ACCI, and I think we've achieved that. You're okay with the ACCI, sir? Okay, right. So that's all he wanted. He just wanted to make sure that he got his fill of ACCI and that he was good to go thereafter. So thank you again, Prof, for coming on that simple request. What's that? On canned ACCI. The real deal. Despite the imperfections, and we do sincerely apologize for glitches along the way, and we know, but generally speaking, I think we're off to a good start. And so we thank you for being here. Further details are available on our conference website. That's fmsarcmona.com. There are also QR codes that are posted on doors and at the registration desk, and I think strategically located elsewhere, that you can just scan. It's above me in terms of technology, but it was done. Thank you to the IT team. The finalized WIMJ supplement will be available electronically. We're making some tweaks and so on, and that will be available as soon as possible. So I invite you now to enjoy our offerings over the next 3 days, 2.5. So tomorrow we begin bright and early, and then of course please come back on Sunday for our ethics seminar. The ethics seminar is simply an extension, the theme is simply an extension of this, which is genomics in health, should we care, right? And so we have an excellent lineup of speakers. There's also a special display on zebrafish as an animal model for the evaluation of psychotic, and I have to write these things down because I will forget, psychotic and herbal supplements on health and behavior, and that is in room 44. So come back after lunch. Lunch is on your own, but come back. You know, there are posters for viewing. Come back to the talks and visit our exhibits, and please do enjoy the rest of your day and the rest of this conference. Thank you.